We are live, and in a few moments, we're going to talk about literacy. Hi, Julia.
Hi, how are you doing this evening?
I'm doing great. How are you?
I'm doing wonderful, thank you.
You know, before we start talking about literacy, I should probably thank my members. I've got three members on this channel, and they are very loyal, and one of them just renewed his membership, and that is my first member, SparrowXIII. And then I have my patron, who is Sofia Slime ASMR. And then I have another member, Jenna H. And they are contributing extra and above board for the health of this channel. And I'm really happy about it. Anyway, if anybody would like to become a member, they can do so. So now we're going to talk about literacy. And you know, literacy is a topic that really applies to almost everybody, and that includes children and adults and humans and chimpanzees. And I guess I can start telling you about my early experiences with literacy, and then you could share some of yours, and then we can move forward. Because, you know, we, as an adult, we have the experience, first of all, learning how to read and then teaching it to others. So, you know, I became literate about age 5, and I was living in Israel, and my native language was Hebrew, and I learned to read, and it was before first grade. And then in first grade, I was suddenly thrown into a classroom where everybody was speaking English, and I didn't know any English. And on top of that, I needed to learn how to read English. but actually, the reading part was the easiest part. Learning the language was a little bit harder. So I can tell you that as I was learning the language and hadn't gotten very far with it, I was already showing my teacher that I could read better than 90% of the class. Okay, because there's something called reading fluency, which has nothing whatever to do with that comprehension. And in our family, we have this tendency to be hyperlexic, which means that we have a mechanical ability to read, even if we don't understand what we're reading. So I was placed in the second to highest reading class because there was a girl in the class who already knew how to read before she entered first grade. Well, I also knew how to read, but not English. So she was in the highest class. And then in the class below her, there was one little boy and myself, and then a lot of other people below that and below that. And the person who, you know, sat next to me was in the lowest class. But she knew English and I didn't, because reading is not the same thing as knowing how to speak a language, and reading is not the same thing as comprehension. I eventually did learn to comprehend English and speak it as well, but that wasn't what I was able to do right at the beginning. And I'm thinking maybe I should share something along these lines. I wrote a book, and it's called Ping and the Snorkely People, mm-hmm. and it recounted the basic experience that I had only from the point of view of a Chinese girl in the United States.
I really love Ping. It's a very well-written book, and I feel like people of all ages can appreciate it to some degree.
Well, thank you. Thank you. Did you want to share some experiences that you had with literacy?
My experiences with literacy, I would say I knew the alphabet for sure by the time I was 4, because I went to preschool and they started teaching us the alphabet, but I can't say I understood like how to read and write it. I just knew like ABC, like I could say it. So by the time I was 5, I learned how to read basic words and sentences, but literacy was very strange when I was young. The teachers were very like just very structured. Like they got mad at us if we weren't like reading silently at a very young age. I just remember that. That's one of my earliest memories.
I think that's very wrong. And I saw this too here when my daughter was going to school. And of course she could read before she was in first grade too. Yeah. But the teachers did not listen to the children reading. It was so strange.
Strange. It's really strange. There's two other things I can say, not me, but even in my sister's generation, that kind of bothered me about this. Okay. That I think is even worse. Like, at least we had spelling tests. By the time my sister was going to school a few years later, my mom was really upset because she was bringing home this journal where they were writing stories and all the words were misspelled, like everything, like so many. So my mom was like, I'm trying to help my child learn how to spell correctly, but this isn't helping when you don't have spelling tests. And the teachers would just sit there and say, oh, well, you know, we went to these workshops that taught that's going to inhibit a child's like creative flow and they'll learn how to spell on their own and they don't need spelling tests. Like they just need to write. She goes, this doesn't make any sense. They don't even know what they're writing. Like this is how bad it was. A lot of misspelled words. And they're like, it'll be fine. Actually, it wasn't fine. A lot of the kids that went to school, like she's a few grades lower than me, I think they misspell a lot of words to this day because that was one of the trends I remember. And it was very frustrating for us. I know that's a silly thing to mention about literacy, but I just remember.
No, it's okay. That actually puts me to mind of something else that happened when I was in first grade. They actually had us write phonetically, read and write phonetically.
Oh, yes.
Yeah, and there was this whole phonetic system. Now, I didn't know that wasn't how you actually read. And I could have had all sorts of problems the next year when we moved to a different state. But my father signed me up for a reading club, you know, a book club, that is. It was the Weekly Reader Book Club. And that's where I got that first book about the monarch butterfly.
Aww.
And its travels. And I read the book anyway. So those books were not written phonetically. They were written the standard way. Mm-hmm. So I learned pretty fast to read the standard way. And because I was hyperlexic, it really, you know, it didn't matter to me how it was written. I learned how to do it pretty fast.
Yes, you have a very high fluency with literacy. So that's to your benefit, I think, right?
Yeah. So I could have been really confused by the way that was taught. But as it happened, I came out of it okay, and it wasn't hurt by it.
Yeah, that's one thing I was going to mention too. Like I had pretty good teachers, but what I would say about reading is I think the thing that just helped me the most was my mom would always buy us a lot of books and we went to the library and just a lot of independent reading on our own. Because if I just relied on the way that they taught us to read in school, I don't think that's very helpful where by the time you're in first grade, oh no, you need to read silently. And I would say kids mispronounce a lot of words because yes, the teacher wasn't correcting them sometimes. I think so.
Yeah, no, we did have a pretty good teacher in first grade, and she divided us into groups, and then we would read out loud, and she would listen and correct. And so that part was very good.
No, yeah, I don't, my first grade teacher did not do that. very just like permissive, like, oh, okay, just go read, do the math, figure it out yourself. So I, at a young age, I was like, okay, let's figure out how to do it ourselves. And they would just be throwing all this stuff at us. And you're like, okay, figure out how to do it yourself. That's very interesting. I had a couple teachers that were more hands-on, but not until later. So that was my interesting experience with literacy, I suppose.
Okay, so then I'm going to tell you that when I was 12 years old, my brother was born. And my brother is a prodigy. And so he started reading at 3 years of age. And, you know, he was doing sums and multiplication. Wow. And he was figuring out the square root of numbers and all sorts of things. Okay, so, but I still read to my brother. Even though he could read, he enjoyed being read to. And I remember one of the books that I read to him, we both like this book, is The Secret River.
Oh, yeah, I remember that.
Yeah, it's by Marjorie Kennan Rawlings. Yeah, I think it's something like almost the last thing she wrote, or anyway, it was bound as a manuscript after her death. And it's really a great book. And I actually read that on YouTube for Bo for a while. So you can look that up. In fact, I wrote about it on Hub Pages. I don't know whether I should share that now, but I think I'll share it later.
Okay.
Anyway, by the time I was 16 and my brother was 4, I was in the Girl Scouts because I was studying at home and that was my socialization to be in the Girl Scouts. And we volunteered to help at a Head Start program. Now, do you know what a Head Start program is?
Yeah, there it's similar to preschool, but I think it's for like low income families in our area anyway. That's what Head Start is.
Yes, that's what it was. They told us that these children were at risk for having problems with reading later on because their parents didn't read to them. So we were to go in there and just read to the children, you know, find a child, say, mm-hmm. Hey, would you like me to read you this storybook? And read to them. And I thought that would be so much fun until I got there and tried that. And the children were very nice, but they would not sit still and they did not want to be read to.
Yes, Head Start, actually as a substitute teacher, I ended up covering a Head Start class. That was a very interesting experience because they didn't have, and yes, it was a very hyperactive classroom and I remember not a lot of structure. I do remember that.
Yeah, but it was okay. I understood that these were preschool children that weren't gonna sit in tears and listen to a teacher or anything. That was okay. But I thought each of us, since we were a whole group of teenagers,
yes.
coming in, each of us could volunteer to read to one child or two, you know.
Yeah, I would think so, because I remember being in preschool, like I was telling you, we began to learn the alphabet. And I remember high school students would actually walk across where my preschool was. But this is a paid preschool, so it's a little bit different. And they would sit with kids and read. So that sounds reasonable, right?
Yeah, I could not get any child to sit still for me to read to them. And it was so strange an experience because it's not like I wasn't used to children that age. I had a brother that age and I read to him at home. And so that was the first glimpse that I had that it isn't just the opportunity to be read to that is important. The child has to be ready to be read to. The child has to want to be read to. You can't force that on anybody, you know.
And this progresses, actually, this literacy issue progresses throughout school when they're forcing the kids to take this, like, academic class. Oh, sit there and pass this exam. Some of them don't want to sit in class. That can get interesting.
Okay, well, I mean... It's just that everybody comes into the world with a different ability. Those children were hanging upside down from the monkey bars. They were bouncing off the walls. They were very healthy children. There was nothing wrong with them. They were not retarded. They just did not want to sit still. That's all it was.
Yes.
Exactly. Yeah. And you can't, there was no point in taking them away from their, you know, telling their parents, oh, bring them here and we'll socialize them differently from the way you are at home. Their parents were probably just fine. They were just dealing with the children the way they were, you know?
Yes, exactly. And they just, I will say this, though, it's going to be a different type of family structure. It's kind of what I'm seeing more now, where there aren't a lot of like rules in that certain type of house. And I'm not trying to get down on these families. They're very healthy kids, but like, okay, you're in a public place like a library and you're telling kids that they can't run it up and down the stairs or hit a mouse on a table. And their parents are like, but they express themselves this way. Cause in their
Those parents who say that, those are not those low income parents. Those sound like liberal parents.
Oh, they're liberal parents for sure. Like let the kids.
Okay. So let's not confuse the low income parents with the liberal, you know, cause
yeah, low right.
parents usually do know how to tell their children to, you know, not do something.
Yes.
You know, that would disturb the public or get them in trouble or get a police officer on them.
Yeah.
They do know that. It's just that, you cannot expect the parent to shape the child. The child is a person too, and the child has certain proclivities. And some people are hyperlexic and some people are not. And they will learn how to read at their own pace when they're ready, you know, but not when somebody else decides they're going to sit down and listen to a story.
Yes.
And it doesn't, it's not, you know, there are stories of children adopted and brought up in a different home. They're not going to behave like the unadopted children. You know, they behave differently because they're individuals, you know, and they come with their own abilities and interests and personalities.
Yes.
So anyway, so that was another experience that I had at a very, you know, I was 16, of what literacy would look like. And then I remember when I was a college student, I got to tutor a child that was having some problems with literacy. And I thought, okay, I'll teach him how to read. And I said, get a book that you're really interested in, you know, and he was interested in, I guess, Star Wars or something like that. He was maybe a 12-year-old. He brought the book in, so I asked him to read it to me. He read beautifully. There was absolutely nothing wrong with the way he read. But then after we stopped reading, you know, after the reading, I asked some questions, and it turned out he couldn't remember a thing that he read.
Oh.
And so that's a different issue, right?
It's a comprehension issue, it sounds like, in that case.
Yeah, but it may be not really comprehension.
Or information retention maybe issue.
I don't know. Yes, because I spoke to him. He wasn't stupid.
So it's definitely an information retention
issue. Right. So I wasn't really equipped to solve this problem. It was way beyond. Again, there are lots of issues that you think, oh, I'll help. I can help. I know how. But then you realize that you don't know how because there's more to this topic than you ever thought about before. You know?
Yes. That's a good point.
Yeah. So we have to humble ourselves and realize we're not going to save the world and we're not even going to save this person until we understand what the problem is, you know, and then we have to figure out how to resolve the problem.
So I have a question for you, Aya, like when there's a child that's struggling with reading and writing and they create like an IEP program, you know, educational program to help them with reading and writing. Do you think there's certain things that might be a little bit too grandiose that they're just pushing on certain children more than like maybe we should make these things more structured to the child? What do you think about that?
Well, it's supposed to be an IEP is supposed to be structured to the needs of the particular child. It's an individual educational class.
But I feel like sometimes it's not. I feel like sometimes, okay, an administrator might have these ideas like, I am going to have this child do X, Y, and Z. And the teacher and the parent will be like, well, this child has certain special needs and you can't emphasize that they're going to get here, but it makes the school look good. I've just heard this. I haven't experienced this particular case, but I've heard about this.
Well, okay. From what I've seen, a lot of times special education in all its different phases, they send the worst teachers enough. You know, a lot of times it's not the best teacher who is assigned that task. It's a teacher who herself might be struggling with something. And then the children are kept there, and so they don't get to interact with the rest of the class during, their the important classes. I mean, they get to go in for something that's entertainment, but not,
Yeah, the
you know.
more curriculum type.
Yes, exactly. So they don't get to experience what everybody else is experiencing. And as long as they don't move forward, they are kept back. And they can be kept back that way for 12 years, about, all the way through high school.
And that doesn't really help the child. I feel like in many cases, it's unfortunate.
Yeah, that's true. Okay. But again, I'm not a special education teacher, and I do
No,
not.
I'm sure. Yeah, no. I just, it was just a thought in my mind, but anyway, I just was
Yeah,
curious.
no. I mean, so I had this idea that I was going to teach a chimpanzee how to read and write. And teach him language. And so I adopted Bo. So at the same time, I had Sword 2.5 years older. And we experienced books together. Yes, thank you. Show that again.
See, this is her book, and it's a story about one book and sword.
Yes, when Sword met Bo.
Yeah, I said it backwards, sorry.
Right, because Bo didn't realize he was meeting Sword until a little bit later, and that was part of the topic. But, she was reading. He was exposed to books right from the start. Yes, he was kind of bouncing off the ceiling like a Head Start child. So he didn't always attend, or he didn't always seem to be paying attention when Sword was concentrating. Sword was sitting still and concentrating. And Sword herself was faced with the fact that we spoke Hebrew at home, and in school it was English. And she had a certain amount of social anxiety about that. So she was reading, but she wasn't talking to anybody in school, which is kind of weird. But when she got to feeling really fluent in her English reading, she told me that she wanted to read it to the man who worked at the post office. Now, at our post office, this was our last postmaster because we live in a very small town. And after he retired, they closed the post office. We do have it open like half a day, but there's no postmaster. But he was a very nice man. He was very friendly to everybody who came in. He was a Vietnam vet. And he was a very lovely person. And she felt comfortable with him in a way that she didn't with her teachers at school. She was in preschool at the time. And the reason I sent her to preschool was because I wanted her to make sure that she learned English before first grade, so they didn't decide that she was somehow disabled or something like that and put her in special
Yeah,
class.
exactly. That's a good move because I feel like a lot of kids.
Yeah, but maybe if I had let her sort of trudge it out the way I had in first grade, then she wouldn't have had this whole issue with selective mutism. Anyway, she took her Dr. Seuss book and she read it cover to cover to the postmaster, and he was very complimentary about her reading. And with every person that she felt comfortable with, there was a lady, her name was Mrs. Boren, and she was an older lady, and we used to visit her, and
Oh.
Sword would read to her. But she would be like totally silent in school,
But you see, I think that just goes to show there are people in the community that a child will feel more comfortable with than their teacher, and they're still demonstrating they can read. So it's a wonderful story.
Yeah, but then when when they were in school and when it was already first grade, nobody would listen to the children read. They had a policy they were not to read in front of anybody. And they were asked to take AR tests. Do you know what AR
Yes,
tests?
it's the accelerated reader test. That's a little bit after my time, but I remember the kids were always coming in looking for the AR books, and I thought, oh, that's interesting. And it seemed like it was just geared towards having them pass multiple choice tests on the computer in our area anyway. I don't know how sordid
That's
it.
how it was.
It's very strange.
And this is something that really goes against, it doesn't allow the person with reading fluency to have any upper, I had the upper hand over children who were fluent in English when I didn't know English because I was such a good reader. Sword was denied having that, that little boost to her ego, or, she was never acknowledged for what a great reader she was. And
Wow.
children who could not read at all had other people read the book to them and then answer the AR test.
See, that's so interesting. So, did they do it at home? Like, because in our area, the kids were supposed to go to school and do it by themselves.
Well, they did the AR test at school. You could take the book home and
Oh,
read
I see
it.
what you're saying. So, somebody was reading it to them, and that gave them like an edge, whereas Sword could read it by herself and she had a higher fluency, but they were getting the same, more of an.
Yeah, but she didn't understand the culture. So then there would be a question, what do you think so and so should have done? Or what was the faux pas that so and so committed? What shouldn't they have said? Or, stuff like that that she didn't know how to answer because she wasn't socialized the same way as everybody else. And so then she got the idea she was a bad reader.
That's horrible. That's horrible. That doesn't make me feel good about the AR test if a
Yeah,
very
no, it's a terrible thing. So I'll have you know that Sword, graduated from college, and so she's fine. And now that she's not in college anymore, she has started reading for fun.
no,
She says,
see? Yeah.
yeah, but the whole educational process of putting that in there, that just ruined it.
Yeah, I remember the kids, like they seemed very fanatical about having to find an AR book. They couldn't find any other book that would be interesting.
Yeah, and you weren't allowed to,
Educational book.
yeah, they're not allowed to read a book that is above their level. They have
That's
to prove that they get 100% on a particular level before they can go on to the next. So if they don't agree with the test writer about what's right and what's wrong, they never get to read the next highest level, the next higher level. And, the whole time when I was learning how to read English, I was reading books that I didn't understand, but I was learning a little bit at a time
And that's
because.
how it works because you can interact with any text. It's so ridiculous that they're trying to keep a kid at a certain level. I'm not a really big fan of like certain movements in education, as I said with my sister, because the spelling, the not giving the spelling test, she still to this day has a difficult time spelling certain words because of that. And they never really did catch up. I mean, you could on your own, of course. But the average person isn't going to be motivated to go out and learn how to, you know what I'm saying, if you're not motivated to read on your own. So I didn't understand the whole point of, oh, give them just more creativity not to have a spelling test or not to look a word up. That's very strange to me. What was the motivation behind that?
I don't know if they intentionally do this to sabotage people or not, but it works that way. I think it works that way for everyone.
I feel
But
like it was,
anyway,
yeah, anyway, that was just my question with
yeah.
that bit.
Yes. Yeah, no, it's a good question. But so I continued to read to Sword at home, and I'll have you know that when I was growing up, long after I could read, my father used to read me at bedtime. And he would read me stories that were a little bit above, what people my age were probably reading. So he read me Quo Vadis, in the Hebrew translation when I was 8 years old. And we would read like one chapter at a time. We wouldn't like try to read the whole thing. And so when Sora was at school, I read to her and to Bo after dinner. This was while she's still in elementary school And you can see how very well, you know, you can see that we used this book up. It was brand new when we got it, but by the time we were done with it, it looked like this, the Golden Compass. And I read it to Sword, I read it to Bo, and they each had remarks to make about it. You know, and her remarks were more sophisticated, obviously, but he also had things to say about it. He would say, so-and-so is a very bad person. You know, it would be that. It was always something like that. Oh, this person should be, you know, thrown away or very bad person, you know. And Sword had somewhat more sophisticated comments to make. But it was interesting comparing them. And I remember I wrote about this on Hump Pages. But I could not, today when I was researching, I could not find that article at all.
Well, another problem, that's one thing with Hub Pages, not only have they de-indexed certain articles, but now it's almost impossible to find quite a large bulk of our articles. And I wouldn't keep writing there, honestly. Like, people are, they're still playing that little game.
No, I'm not.
Not you, but I'm just very disappointed with what happened. I need to probably take my material off there and move it somewhere someday, but honestly, I just don't have the time to do that.
Well, anything you want to place on Pub Wages, I would certainly.
Oh, I would love to do that. I might actually start, like, it's a time process, but I would like to put it on Pub Wages where it would have better, like, longevity, in my opinion. And everybody should check out Pub Wages. It's a very literary website.
Yeah. So I don't know whether I should. I feel that maybe some people are finding this conversation boring. So maybe I'll share a little bit more of the footage of me and Bo as we're reading. This week we read this book and I finished it. And of course, Bo just, you know, he's always involved in whatever I'm doing. I'm not saying that he read the whole book or anything, but I always involve him with it. So let me see if where we stopped, I can do a screen share. And oh, these are our chickens and ducks, and they're teasing the dog. And this is a picture from way back when Sword and Bo used to read together. Reading Great Expectations this week. He always seems to point to certain words that he thinks are important. We just hang out together outside when I have time, and I read. Sometimes I read out loud for him. He listens.
Whom you loved.
Okay, so I'm going to take that out. So that was a sort of a musical interlude, but anyway.
I actually really enjoyed that little video, though, how you put everything together with the Great Expectations. It was kind of fun to watch.
Yeah, so, you know, way back when we read this one, and now we read this one, Great Expectations. And Bo has always been exposed to reading from the very beginning. But I thought maybe I should share a little bit about his literacy and Project Bo. And in order to do that, I'm going to have to try to do my screen sharing, and if it doesn't work, please forgive me. So let me see. What I want to share is on the other screen, and so Bo and literacy. Now, if I could just get it to go up. This is an article that I published on Hub Pages a very long time ago. Can you see it, Julia?
I
do
see it. Yeah, I see Beau and literacy, and I see a picture of a much younger Beau. He looks like a young one there.
Yeah, and his bench, that was his old bench. He has a much sturdier bench now. So I'm going to read the beginning of this here. For a long time, I've held off on publishing the next part of the story for many reasons. This is the place where Beau's development shatters what everyone believed so far about the cognitive abilities of chimpanzees. This is a contribution to science, and it ought to be published in a scientific journal, not on Hub Pages. I've tried to find the right forum in which to publish our breakthrough, but it has been rejected here. Some of the colleagues in primatology believe that I should just sit on the findings until I have more proof, enough proof to convince the most skeptical, enough proof to get funding, enough proof to make all our problems go away. However, it's been over a year, and I believe that Beau and I have to hold on for the long haul, the sort of objective double-blind testing that the scientific establishment wants will not be forthcoming anytime soon, for reasons that I will explain in detail in later hubs. Meanwhile, we still have to live, eat fresh food, and pay our bills. We have to keep doing what we're doing, even if there is no support. And we have to share this with the public, because people need to know that we exist, that we haven't given up, and that what has been published about chimpanzees is not all there is to know. So over here is the transcript of what happened when Eden entered. He entered the picture, and at this point, Beau was still looking at lexigrams. And Julia, do you know what the lexigrams were? Let me just go ahead and stop the share right now, and we can talk about it.
Okay.
So, do you understand what the lexigrams were that we were using for Beau?
Were they words that were in Hebrew and English? I could be wrong, but I thought
no, that's right. Complete words. So we started with complete words, and he would point at them.
Oh yeah, I remember, because you had the video where he would be he points fast, and he would take the person's hand and kind of like guide them.
Yes, that's right. And then it turned out that he could actually, you know, if we put the letters there, he could spell the word and he could point to the word. So you can read all about that. I guess there's no point in my reading it to the public, but it's all over there, and we have the link down below.
And I think you have a little bit in that Project Beau video, right?
There's a Project Beau DVD, which tells the entire story. Yes, with videos, you know, of each thing that happened. So Beau was literate in the sense that he knew how to spell words, not necessarily in the sense that he sat around reading novels, you know?
Yeah, he wasn't reading Great Expectations when he was five.
but not was. Right, exactly. But he could spell what he wanted, and he could spell what he thought, and he could tell me things like that the mice were crying.
I remember that, because you said when you put the pests, like, didn't you, and he didn't like it, right? Because they were dying, so they had to take it out. I do remember that story.
Yeah. So he told me things that I didn't know. And that's how I knew that I wasn't hallucinating, and it wasn't, you know, just all in my mind.
That's funny.
And yeah. And he told other people things that they couldn't possibly know.
Wow. That's really neat. Well, I think he has a sense of things that are happening in the environment that we might not be able, auditory senses or heightened.
He can hear things. And you know, Julia, the more I think about all of this, the more I realize that we don't really understand other animals and the sounds they make, because we don't have the same auditory equipment as they have to hear each other.
This is so true. It's very true.
So I went in, you know, when I went into this as a linguist, I thought, okay, chimpanzees are impaired. Well, not impaired, you know, but that's a wrong word. But I was thinking they don't have the ability to make consonants. So therefore, we have to give them a way to select signs so that they can use language. So that's why I thought literacy was a good way. You know, in the past, other people used sign language, but they weren't people who were fluent in sign language. So then people will say, who speak American Sign Language said that chimp didn't really say that because, you know, first of all, their hands are a little bit different from ours and they can't make exactly the shapes. But also, the people teaching them sign language were not fluent in sign language. They weren't members of the deaf community. So, you know, they weren't really that good at it.
Well, that's really interesting to me, though. Are there still chimpanzees that sign nowadays, and can somebody sign some things to them? I'm just curious.
Well, I mean, Washoe was the last of them, I think, and she was in Washington State. I think that she has since passed away.
Okay. I was just curious.
But people did not, you know, people did not believe that she was actually communicating. Also, Coco, the gorilla, was said to use sign language, and she has since passed away. But a lot of people criticized that project as well.
That's
So,
unfortunate. That's too bad that they couldn't have more of an open mind about it.
but you know, I was aware of the criticism, so I followed Sue Savage Rumbaugh, and I used lexigrams. Except that her lexigrams looked like pictures, and mine looked like, you know, letters and words.
Yeah, which I kind of actually like better, but that's kind of my
Yeah.
preference.
Anyway, you know, Bo was able to communicate using language, using literacy, but that didn't necessarily mean that he was, you know, a reader,
I
if you
mean,
see what I'm saying.
well, like we said, he's not going to sit down and read Great Expectations, but I have seen you communicate with him in Hebrew and English, and he seems to understand both. Like you have conversations with him and you guys interact with books. So there is literacy taking place. It might just
There
not look like.
is literacy. I mean, there are times when I'm reading him a book and I say a word and he points at that word at right
And
that
he's pointing at
minute.
work, he's holding the book and he's intent on it. It probably just doesn't look exactly the way that a scientific panel might want it to look, but how do we know? Because how many people, I think you're the only person I know that's actually tried to teach a chimpanzee how to read and write. I haven't heard about anybody else doing this, so how do we know? Like, has anybody else done this?
Well, not that I know of, but then
That's
again,
what
if
I'm
they
saying.
did, you know, because most people don't know that I have, you know.
But I think it's kind of cool. I mean, you're doing something that's kind of like innovative. It's too bad that people that are interested in grooming don't realize that you're doing this, which is more interesting, really, I think.
Yeah, and you know what? The whole grooming thing wouldn't happen if we weren't talking to each other. This is
Exactly. Yeah, because that's a big part of communication.
Right. You know, that people, you know, that expect every day that there's going to be a terrible falling out between me and Beau and something terrible is going to happen. But, you know, I raised him and we eat all our meals together, you know, every single day.
Going to happen,
And
and people need to stop sensationalizing. That's it. That's their problem.
yeah. And so we have a relationship. I'm his mom. No, he's not always happy with me, but he has ways of communicating that as well, you know?
And you also know not like you treat him well and he treats you well. It's not like some antagonistic, like you guys have boundaries, so it's
Yeah,
healthy.
we have boundaries and we set the boundaries pretty early.
Yeah, see, so I think people need to respect that. And if they want to know more about it, they could watch what you've done instead of just like jumping to conclusions, you know?
Yeah. Well, I would hope that they would.
I mean, Bo's 20 years old now. That's kind of a big thing. I had to have spent 20 years with him doing this. It's kind of amazing, really. I mean, it's
Yeah.
not what I'd want to do, but it's pretty. I don't know anybody else who's done this. There's nobody else.
Yeah, and I found a way to do it without the funding, and we are okay.
I believe in that. I think it's better to do it without the funding because you can do it your way and you can do it in a way that works. That's what I think.
Right. Yes. And I continue to be amazed at the things that he can do. And by the way, in February 16th, he will be 21.
Oh my gosh. See, I'm telling you, this is a success story. Anybody that's interested in like the actual story behind Bo should be interested in this. It's pretty amazing.
Yeah. So I don't know. If you want to support Project Bo, and if you have a child at home, you might want to buy When Sword Met Bo, because it's a great story. If you have a child at home and a new baby, and there might be some jealousy or something of that sort, it's a great way to talk about the issue. You know, children all over the world have read the story. Down below, there's a link to a lady who did who runs a preschool in the Philippines.
Oh, yes.
With her charges. Julia, would you be able to share it? Because I'm terrible at screen sharing. Do you think you could share
it? I can see if I can still find that particular story. I will have to go search.
It's down below in the.
Okay.
The link is in the description.
Okay. So I'll have to go look for the video because I don't have that up on the computer. I did that via my phone. So let me take a look.
Oh, okay. Let me see if I can give you the link.
I probably can. I just don't want anything to make a sound in the background. That's kind of what I'm worried about. I might have to mute things for a second.
Oh, okay. That's okay. We don't really have to. Maybe I did not. Maybe I'm
wrong. I'll find it. Let's see.
I mean, what I really love is the pictures of the children who are reading it and being read to. And so the story actually it adds to the literacy in the world, you know, and to the language learning of those children. I'm going to put this in the chat.
Oh.
Julia, can you see what I put in the chat?
Okay. I think I found it.
It's in the chat.
Okay. Coming back, I think. I found it.
Okay.
Just took me a while to get there. See it?
Yeah. Wonderful. Yeah. Wonderful. So she has some pictures.
Oh, yeah. There we go.
Yeah.
That's a wonderful picture. I really love that. Let's see. Oh, I love this. That is so cute.
Yeah.
So everybody should, what I want to suggest, everybody should go check it out in the description.
Yeah. Very good. Very good. Yeah, I actually have it right there.
You have it right there.
Yeah.
Well, at least we got some pictures momentarily. And by the way, I'm getting a new computer, so I feel like it's going to be a little bit better for sharing things and for OBS. Okay. Yeah, I just wanted to share that. I know it's not really the topic of the evening, but I think that will be kind of exciting because I want to practice OBS in a very real way again.
Okay. Yeah, once we have OBS, we can master the world, right?
Yeah, and I'm really excited actually. So because we could share things like that and have them built in. Well, you know.
Right. So I also let me try to share it this time. I also have done some writing about hyperlexia, and for those people who have autistic children, this might be helpful. So I'm going to try to share the article. about that. So that's where I actually did have this review of When Sword Met Bow. It's by Michelle Simtico on Hub Pages, and you might want to see that. By the way, this is my article about the Secret River. And in this article, there are pictures of me reading to Bo, and Bo reading also. So there's
so fun. It's like a look back on Hub Pages content. I really love it.
And these are the wonderful, wonderful illustrations in this book. Wow. I love this. There's a new edition out, and it has different illustrations, very pretty too. But I love the old ones that are just like two-tone.
Yeah, I like, there's just something about it. They're very, it draws you into the story without being overwhelming, if that makes any sense.
Right. And I thought that I also had like a link to a video, because I did in fact have a video of that.
Probably did. If you're thinking about it on Hub Pages, I've noticed they've taken some of the capsules away recently when I
went. There it is.
You found it. Okay, good. You found it. What I didn't like though, Aya, is they took our comment section away, and I can't understand why would I want to, because the comment section is part of the article. That's a little disappointing.
Yeah, well, they basically ruined it. You know, I'm not writing new articles there. I never moved all of them to Pub Voyages.
I haven't moved enough. I need to start doing it.
So I can go to YouTube with this. But then it's going to show me the ads. Skip ads. Tell me if you can hear.
I don't hear it yet, but maybe, let's see. That's the one thing about when we share a YouTube video, we don't always hear the sound, but it seems like when we share the video, the way that you were showing me to do it here on StreamYard. But here's the thing. I think once we get OBS, we'll be able to work around that.
Okay. So you're saying
you don't hear the sound. Yeah, unfortunately. But that seems to be a StreamYard issue.
Yeah, I guess so.
Anyway,
anybody who wants to watch it, I could share the link for it. And I can put that in our chat.
I wonder if anybody watching also, if you wanted to share in the comments, like what were your first literary or literacy experiences? That would be interesting. So we could see and, you know, comment on those.
Right. So anybody who wants to watch, this is the link, and it's in the chat, and you can actually see that. So I continue the tradition in my family of reading this particular book to my children, and I had read it before to my brother.
Aw, I love that tradition, that you have that family literacy tradition of reading a particular story.
So this is the article that I thought maybe would be of interest to any parents who have a very bright child, maybe an early reader, who is now having trouble with reading comprehension.
Mm-hmm.
And I don't know, it looks like there might be a problem loading that picture, doesn't it?
Yeah, it's taking a time loading. Maybe you can, if you want to show the picture, you could try right clicking on it, opening it in a new browser. And maybe
it's not actually a very important picture.
Okay.
So this is just an explanation about what is hyperlexia and what you can do to improve comprehension. And I'm going to go ahead and share the link for that too.
Okay. Sounds good to me. I love all these links because this way they're in the description, but you can also see them in the comments too. So,
right. In chat. So now I'll share this link. So there are techniques that you can use if you do have a hyperlexic child to learn, to help them learn to read between the lines, which is something that, you know, all of those multiple choice tests are testing. They don't care anymore.
No, they don't. And there's another problem with the multiple choice test. Some kids have a very low literacy, even a comprehension, and they're just very good at guessing patterns. And some little kids would say, oh, I can guess a pattern and I get 100% because I just, so, and they're not comprehending a thing that they're reading. They just know the pattern. Some people are good guessers.
Yeah, and some people just are good at reading between the lines. They can tell what answer the test writer intended.
Now, what they want you to think about the story. But here's the problem. It's subjective. A different person could think something entirely different about the story. So,
right, exactly. But if a child, you know, what happens with the normal kids, you know, the normies, is they automatically know that they're not supposed to answer the truth, but they're supposed to answer what the teacher wants, you know, or the test writer wants to be said. But if you have a very socially naive person, like an autistic child, they'll tell you what they think, not what they think somebody else thinks, you know?
And the thing that bothers me about that is I feel like a lot of teachers, even to this day, they're not very sensitive of, like, you know, an autistic child and something they might say. And I feel like sometimes they might belittle them just because, oh, that's not a neurotypical response, you know, and that bothers me a little bit.
Yeah. But I mean, they even do this automatically through the tests, which are considered to be objective.
They're not. I mean, what test is objective? Every test is subjective. I don't think there's one objective test on the planet. Nothing's objective. Everything's subjective. Can we just be honest? Like,
well, I mean, look, in math, there are...
Yeah, maybe math is the exception, but even science has, like, a certain bias, like, depending on who is interpreting the science. Like,
well, yeah, it's a problem. So, anyway...
It's just interesting. I just think, you know, that's just the way I see it without getting too deep into it.
Right. So you're reading Great Expectations too, Julia. Right?
Yes, but the thing is, I want to bring it home because I do enjoy it, but I've only got to page 43. Oh, I do not like Mrs. Joe. She's just so, like, you know what's funny though? She's just so bossy. And then, oh, but the part that really annoys me, I get the part like, oh, I raised you by hand. Like, oh yes, with your hand. It's just so like, oh, like, we're supposed to praise her. And then it's so true though, even to this day, like, the company comes over and they're praising her for, like, raising this child that's not her own child, even though she's the older sister. And it's just like, she's so narcissistic. She's a narcissist. Oh my gosh.
Yes, she is.
Yes. That would be interesting. Like, I haven't gone that far into it, but I just thought it was funny that he decided to take the food and give it to the prisoner, because I'm like, she's so weird and so, like, stringent about everything, and I'm just like, oh, I haven't got that far yet, but I really do not like her character. So yes, I'm reading it too at the very beginning. I have not finished.
That's good. I'm glad that you are, and once you are done, I would like to invite you to be a guest on my other channel, Inverted A Press, where we can have a literary discussion about the merits of the book, Great Expectations by Charles Dickens.
You know, I'm excited, and I love that you've had some other discussions about books on there as well that people should check out.
Right. So, you know, even adults vary in the way that they acquire literacy in a first or a second or third or whatever language. And recently I've been teaching some people how to read Hebrew, and they're adults. They're all adults. There are no children there. And I see a multitude of different strategies that they use to try to acquire literacy. And some people are, you know, very good at the mechanical part of, you know, just reading it. They don't have to know what it means, but they just read it really well, relatively speaking. And then other people, oh my goodness, they can't do that at all. But that doesn't mean they don't have language ability, because they might be much better at something else, such as dividing words into syllables.
Exactly. Yeah. There's different aspects of reading comprehension, literacy, and everybody has a different level where they're at.
Yeah. But I mean, we're not talking about children.
We're talking about adults. We're talking about adults. Yes. I think that's just realistic, though. Not everybody's going to be at the same level learning a new language.
Right. Exactly. So there are different strategies, and some of them work better than others. And I'm learning all about that. And in the process of teaching, I might come up with some ideas about how to make that easier too.
That would be interesting. I think it sounds like a fun challenge to learn a second language, but honestly, like, I've taken a few courses, dabbled in it, but I really need to be more disciplined about it. But some people are really good. They just learn a second language, I don't know, in a few weeks or something. There are people that do that. Many different levels of literacy, obviously.
Yeah, that's true. So to summarize, literacy on the very basic level is being able to map sounds onto letters, okay? Mm-hmm. And some people have an ingrained ability to do that very quickly, and others have to struggle with it.
Mm-hmm. This is true.
After you master that part, there's another part that has to do with the semantics and understanding and comprehension and even culture. Mm-hmm. And, you know, some people are great with comprehension, but terrible with the mechanics of reading, and some people are the exact opposite.
I mean, it makes sense, right?
Yeah. And you really can't, I mean, I think part of the problem with the educational establishment is that they think that all they have to do is take all the children and give them exactly the same growing up environment, and they will be equal in every way.
But that's not possible. They've been trying to do that forever. There's been different renditions of this. They're like, we're going to make everybody the same. We're not all the same. And that's not fair. That can be an impediment to a child who maybe would benefit from having their own tailored reading and writing program. Yeah.
Right. Which is, and the best way to do that is to just homeschool them, because then the parent knows what each child needs. And even if two different children, you know, one needs this and one needs that, you can give them what they need.
I've been seeing more people actually since the pandemic are actually going to homeschooling, or some people, if they're not completely homeschooling, some people are doing a charter school where I guess they meet a few days, like hours per week. But they do most of the coursework at home, and then the parents supplement with their own activities. I've been seeing that more too lately.
Yeah. I heard that right now in Texas, they're having trouble meeting their quota of teachers. People just don't want to teach under those circumstances.
This is so true pretty much everywhere. I heard in Nevada, there's a $5,000 signing bonus to be a teacher. And my dad's like, that sounds really good. And I said, well, not to me, but I'm sure they're going to have a high atrophy rate. Once again, there's a reason they can't fill these classrooms, because there's so many different standards that the teachers have to teach to the class. There's no creativity, just my opinions, but it's not the same as when I was younger. I thought it was a little bit more flexibility.
Yeah.
So maybe homeschooling's not a bad thing. It might be a good thing, actually, is what I'm trying to say.
Yeah, it might be very good. And maybe some of those teachers who don't want to teach in the classroom would be willing to be tutors, working in different homes.
Well, that's the one thing that's very interesting. There are some very literate young children, and their parents hire a tutor for every subject, and they can learn about any topic they want. And the sky's the limit, really. It doesn't hinder you not to be in public school. Like, in some ways, it's probably to your benefit not to be.
Yeah. Right.
But I know everybody has their own opinions on this, but I know a lot of really intelligent people that have homeschooled their children. So I think there's some stereotypes about it.
Well, they're always over. Yeah. So do you want to see some of the other books that we read in this household?
Of course.
Some of them are in Hebrew. So this is Itamar v'Kovat Samim Shachol.
Oh, fun.
Itamar and the Black Magic Hat.
And that's what I was going to say. It must be about a hat because I see the big hat, but I don't speak.
Yes, it's a magic hat. You can be anything when you wear that hat.
It's fun.
This one, Sword was interested in gymnastics, and I had this book about Carrie Strug, Heart of Gold, who won a gold medal while she was injured.
And she I remember herself. That. Yes, I remember that.
And I think that's quite different from what they're telling the young athletes to do today. But
No, that would not fly. But back then you had to meet a certain standard. That was the whole point of the Olympics. You had to meet that standard.
Right. So this one is called Yiddish and Ima.
Is it about a mermaid? I couldn't
remember. No, it's just Mama's boy.
Oh, okay. For some reason, I thought I saw a tail. I'm sorry.
Yeah. And okay, Shilisha. Good Night Moon. We had this in both languages.
I've read that in French and Spanish. I have the Spanish version and the English version somewhere.
Yeah. And but really liked it in both languages.
That's really neat. I think I remember hearing you read that in Hebrew once, too. I remember that.
Yeah, we had some Chinese books, too, but I didn't read them. When June was here, she would read them.
That's really neat.
This is Utsli Gutsli, which is the book to my favorite Hebrew musical.
Aw. What is your favorite Hebrew musical, Aya?
Utsli Gutsli. It means Rumpelstiltskin. It's a story
of... Oh, yes, I actually really like Rumpelstiltskin. There's one problem with Rumpelstiltskin. Like, she wants to find out his name. Why would he all of a sudden be singing it to himself? But maybe I don't understand that. Like, I never... Unless he was such a... I always thought that was so funny.
Yeah. Well, the thing here is it was all about taxation. The king wanted gold, and he was overtaxing the people.
Mm-hmm.
And then he thought he found a solution when the miller said his daughter could turn straw into gold.
I remember that.
That creates inflation, right?
Oh, big time. What kind of gold? No.
This is for children, but it's also for adults. It's really funny.
I mean, you could kind of explain economics with it a little bit, I think.
Yeah. And then, you know, there's the issue between the husband and the wife because the king marries the miller's daughter, but there's this big secret that actually somebody else is doing the turning the straw into gold.
No.
So anyway, it was just the right thing for me when I was 4 years old. I thought this was so deep. You know?
I mean, for a four-year-old, it is a little deep, right? It has different topics going on.
Right. And I went to see the play and I told my mother, I want to see it again. So she thought she was going to be so bored. She had to take me again to see the same play. And she thought it was a children's play. But then when she saw it the second time, she thought, wow, this is a lot deeper than
I thought. Yeah, it was a little bit of nuance. I would say a lot, actually. You can take the post-2020 economy with a parallel to Rumpelstiltskin. Maybe you should talk about it or something. I don't know.
Yeah. Well, anyway, it's a great play. It's by... Abraham Shlonsky, who is one of my favorite children's poets.
Interesting. Okay.
Beau likes Where the Wild
Things. I know everybody loves that one. Am I weird that I didn't love Where the Wild Things Are? It's okay, but I just didn't. I didn't get it.
No, I didn't either. And by the way, Beau did kind of damage this book. He doesn't damage most books, but he did this one. I guess he decided to be wild.
Well, it happens sometimes. Maybe he just was being wild because it said Where the Wild Things Are. So he said, okay, do you want me to do that?
And by the way, when I was looking for books today, I went into the garage and this was on the floor and I saw it.
Oh, yeah. You told me about that. It's the Dickens portrait, right?
No. This is Pushkin.
Oh, I'm sorry.
Yeah, it's so weird, but I saw this and I immediately said, that's Pushkin. Why is Pushkin on this book? You know, he's a Russian author. And it's weird that I recognize that because this is a very rudimentary portrait, but somehow it was really clear to me that that was Pushkin.
Interesting. And that's very cool. Well, yeah. Nick W says hi, is saying hi, Aya. Nick W saying hi to you.
Oh, okay. Let me. Hi, Nick. Are you interested in literacy? Chimpanzee literacy, human literacy. Have you ever read Pushkin's Yevgeny Onegin?
And would you recognize Pushkin? Because I guess I didn't recognize him. I thought it was, never mind.
You know, Pushkin had an African great grandfather. And so you can see the curly hair. You know, he was rich, but
that's cool.
Yeah. This is actually a Hebrew translation of Yevgeny Onegin, you know, into Hebrew from Russian. And, we have some.
There's no Pushkin, he said.
Okay. So, hold on. I'm having trouble with my mouse. Okay. Chimpanzee literacy with Aya and Julia sounds delightful.
Nice.
And he doesn't know Pushkin. Okay. Well, Pushkin. That's okay.
Well, thanks for, you know, sharing, Nick.
Yeah. Yeah. So Beau is a highly literate chimpanzee. I don't know if you got a chance to see the slight video footage that I shared of Beau reading. He was actually reading Dickens. Great Expectations.
He has Great Expectations, A Great Expectations. So did it.
Do you think I should share that again, Julia?
I think that'd be fun. I liked it. Please do.
Okay, let me take it back to where that was happening. So, yeah, okay. That's my clock, what's left of it. The dog barking at them. This is Beau when he was little and my daughter Sword, and they're reading a book together. See, Beau always likes to point out words in books. I don't know if you saw that, but. And here he is reading Great Expectations. See what he does? He did that when he was little too. It's not a word that he. Very important part of the text. And then, you know, when I'm reading, he'll swing on his swing and I'm reading in the hammock and he'll listen. He's interested. Okay. I think that's about
all. Well, that was a nice glimpse into your guys' literary, activities.
Yeah, well, is there anything else that you want to share about yourself or your sisters growing up?
Well, I do love reading. I always enjoyed books. It's a good thing my mom encourage us to read on our own or go to the library and read. Because I feel like if I just were to go off like what the teachers were recommending, I probably wouldn't have loved reading. When I was younger, I realized I did like fiction, but history just started to win out. And I wanted to read about different historical events. And I would start looking up different books at the library. I became really obsessed with like wanting to learn about the Polynesian people and how they traveled across the Pacific. Even though I know Thor Heyerdahl has been debunked to some extent, I still find his books very intriguing, like the Kon-Tiki trip. The fact that he actually tried to do that, I mean, maybe that didn't happen because some of, you know, you've heard about how his theories were debunked, right?
I've heard that they were, but not how. Do you want to tell me how?
Well, because they've said, due to language, the claim is that the Polynesian languages are much more related or similar to like Filipino or Taiwanese language, and they don't believe that they originated in South America. And Thor Heyerdahl had this theory that the Polynesian people came from South America, and he also created this fictional continent. So some of his theories were just debunked because they are a little out there, but he did a couple of things that were really fascinating in this book that I read about the Kon-Tiki. He made a ship that could float from South America to Easter Island. That's pretty interesting. And he erected those statues, the Moai. I thought that was really interesting that he re-erected those. And I just remember reading that book and finding it very fascinating when I was a kid. Mm-hmm. And I was very fascinated with... But here's the thing about Easter Island. How do we know for sure that it was a lush island? Like they keep saying, oh, there's like historical records or documents that there were palm trees all across the island. And they say that, but do we know that for sure? Like, how do we know it wasn't more barren? We don't have like photographs to go back in time to like ascertain that.
Well, I mean, there are ways by digging in the soil and going several.
Yeah, that's what they say. But they also have said recently, maybe it wasn't as lush as they thought. I don't know. It's an interesting debate on Easter Island is what I've heard. But I guess my whole point is I became very fascinated with like Easter Island, Pitcairn, the Pacific, just from books I read on my own.
Yeah, I know you were very interested and still are in.
Oh, Mooney and the Bounty. Oh, I was obsessed with that. Like when I was a kid, they don't teach about that in America. I guess in British, you know, those classrooms, they study about the history of the Bounty. But I was obsessed. Like I read the fiction books, but then I realized, oh, actually the historical story behind it and how Captain Bligh, he wasn't a very good leader, but he was an amazing navigator. And he just was maligned because, well, he wanted to get the breadfruit back to, he had a mission. Okay. His mission was, and some people might not like this nowadays, was to bring breadfruit to the Caribbean. And the slave owners were going to use that as cheap food source for slaves. And you can like his mission or not. And in modern context, a lot of people are very mad about that. But his mission was he wanted to get the breadfruit trees from Tahiti to the Caribbean as quickly as possible. But things kept like delaying them, like the weather. And then his followers didn't want to like listen to him. Like they wanted to stay on the island. He had a lot of disciplinary breakdowns and he wasn't the best leader. He wasn't Captain Cook. He wasn't charismatic. And there was a mutiny. It's just very fascinating. But the mutineers weren't exactly noble people. They just wanted to stay in Tahiti because who wants to go back to England?
Yeah.
It's a very fascinating story. Fletcher Christian was actually probably a very noble man. I think he did believe in his cause, but I think his mind was a little warped because he fell in love with a Tahitian woman and he's being like persuaded by all these men that, oh, you need to mutiny. But it was a disaster because after you mutiny, you have to hide and you're basically going into hiding. And it's, everybody should read about what happened on Pitcairn Island. It's very fascinating. They end up, they made a mistake. I read about this when I was 13 years old. I was so fascinated with it. They made a mistake. They brought some Tahitian men with them and Tahitian women, but they didn't bring enough women for everybody. So there was basically like a little bit of a, you know, war where almost everybody was killed except for two men and all the women were still there. It's a, they reconstructed their society, but it was very fascinating. I read about this when I was 13 years old. I don't know. Some people might not want their children to read about something like that nowadays. They might say, oh no, these topics are like not appropriate for a 13-year-old, but I was able to read what I wanted. Like I didn't have someone say, oh, you can't read that.
Right. Right. Exactly. Exactly.
I learned a lot and it made me want to like look beyond the fictional story and find out what really happened. And then what's really interesting to this day, like I was reading National Geographic and different books. I found out some of the descendants of the mutineers were also taken to Norfolk Island. And Norfolk Island's a very interesting place. You've probably read about it a little bit, right?
No, not particularly.
Their culture is just very interesting. And then the Norfolk pine is actually very, very famous and it's been exported around the world. So there's just all these little things that I found out just through my own reading and nobody taught me about this in a classroom. These were just stories I became fascinated on researching on my own.
Right. I think this is what really happens is once we're out of the educational environment, we can read about what we're really interested in. And different people choose different topics and they get very obsessed with them. Like, for instance, ham keys. At a very early age, started being interested in Jean Lafitte, and she became a historian, not in a university setting, and she uncovered real evidence with regard to Jean Lafitte from primary sources. So
I remember her articles were very well written and very well researched.
Yeah, yeah. So anybody who's interested in that or your articles about Mutiny on the Bounty could go and look those up at historiaobscura.com.
I mean, I think that would be really neat. And it just goes to show, too, that a story you read when you're a child can inspire you on a lifelong voyage to learn more about all sorts of different cultures, all sorts of different places.
Yes, definitely. Definitely. So I think people's experiences with literacy early on can have an effect on their entire life, the entire trajectory of their life. And it's really important to cultivate your child's literacy.
It definitely is. And I think if you encourage a child to read what they want, not tell them what to read, they're going to find their interests and they're going to let those interests navigate the course of, I don't know, what they might want to do with their life or something.
Right. Exactly. Exactly. So, yeah, I think we've covered it, don't you?
I think so, too. Well, I really love that you're the expert on this topic. This is your topic. So thank you for sharing your expertise with us.
Well, thank you, Julia, for telling me your story and your literacy journey as well. And I hope that I can have you as a guest on Inverted A Press so we can discuss Great Expectations in greater detail.
I'm really excited to do that. And I have to say, like, I was afraid. Maybe I was tinged by my opinions of Oliver Twist, which was okay. But I have to say, I guess my experience reading it was kind of complicated by the fact that we had to read it very quickly and a lot of people didn't read it and they were using me as an answer key, like to try and pass an exam. Like, oh, can you help us? And I'm like, why didn't you read the book? And I think I just had a bad experience and it kind of made me think, oh, I don't think I like Dickens, but I'm ending up actually really enjoying what I've read so far of Great Expectations. Maybe I just like it better than Oliver Twist though.
It is better than Oliver Twist. It's one of his best novels. And again, I'm not obsessed with Dickens. I'm not a Dickens fan, but I'll have to admit he's pretty good at writing and he is kind of a comical writer.
Yeah, what I like is I feel like I'm seeing the comedy in his characters, but I do have to say I haven't read Oliver Twist for a long time. So maybe some of my opinions are just tinged by that experience, but Great Expectations is a better story. I'm not saying it's my favorite story of all time, but I'm kind of glad that you started reading it and it made me kind of curious because I had wanted to go back and revisit some of the classics. And this is one I feel like I could stomach, you know?
Okay, good. Yeah. But, you know, these stories are not something like that you have to put on a shelf and worship. They were intended to be entertainment, and that's all.
Exactly. And that's another thing people forget about the classics. In their time, they were considered Pulp Fiction. And now we've kind of, canonized these stories and made them out to be something that, I'm not saying the writing can't be good, but they're not as elevated sometimes as people are giving them credit for, you know?
Exactly. Exactly.
Yeah, that's kind of my opinion on it anyway.
Yeah. Okay. Next week, my guest is going to be David McElroy, and he's going to be talking about, politics.
Interesting. Okay. What, like American politics or world politics? I'm just curious. Like,
American politics with a libertarian leaning.
Okay, that's interesting. As long like I kind of like the libertarian stuff. I'm just kind of over the two party system stuff, but I'll probably tune in if it's a libertarian. That's cool.
And the week after that, our guest is Kate Gladstone.
Nice.
Okay, well, have a wonderful evening, Julia, and thank you so much for joining me here.
Have a good night, Aya.
Bye-bye.
Bye.